questions about this cruise, please feel free to ask me or one of the other deckhands if you walk around here. Yeah. A couple of safety things that you guys on the water. I know Captain Tim went over quite a few things. We do have rays, doorways on the boat, right, for keeping out rainwater. Also, really darn good at tripping people. So be careful walking in and out of these doorways. On second deck, we do need those windows to stay closed. It's a little bit warm up there. But you're more than welcome to head out to the bow section. The windows do need to be down second deck. First deck, you're more than welcome to open up these windows. Heck, you can do whatever you want with the windows. We do, unfortunately, have a capacity on third deck of 41 people. And it does look like we are over capacity at the moment. So if anyone is willing to come down to second or first deck, we do have some spots on our bow, so you'll still be outside on first deck. So if anyone is willing to come down, we would so appreciate that. It was a U.S. Coast Guard regulation that we can only have 41 people up there. So we'll have someone up and start counting here quick. We have a full bar on first deck, and we're going to have a smaller bar on second deck. So if you guys are feeling Bloody Marys or some mimosas,
did you want it?
Just
any drinks in general. Snacks, we do have food aboard on board. So if you're feeling anything like that, first and second deck are the places. We are now approaching Duluth's most famous landmark. This is the aerial lift bridge that we see here. It's built back in 1905, and when it was built, it was a gondola car bridge. And how it worked was there was a gondola car that would go from left to right, from Canal Park over to Minnesota or Park Point. And then in 1929, they realized that it was causing a bit too much traffic on either side of the bridge. And so they built the lift bridge that we see here today. How it works, as you can see, it's raising forest. It goes up for anything over 14 feet, including the Vista Star. It will also, it has a clearance of 132 feet, so it can go all the way to the top and span in under a minute. It's kind of like a train in that there are hands on either side of the bridge that go down the road to traffic, go up. And pedestrians can cross the bridge, and so if they're taking too long, the bridge operator, which sits in that building in the center span you see there, he has no problem using a very loud microphone or horn to get those pedestrians off the bridge. May or may not have happened to me once or twice. You'll see some people on the piers here this morning, so, and after all, they are a peer group. Guys, if you don't feel like waving, don't give in to peer pressure. They gave me the mic, it's early in the morning, so I'm going to do that. Thank you. to the left of us here, this is going to be Canal Park. Many of you might be staying here in Canal Park. It's very popular now. But back in the day, it used to be just abandoned warehouses, and not much was going on down here. And Duluth citizens realized that it was prime real estate for them. And so they renovated a lot of the existing buildings, the existing structures, into the shops that you see here today. As you can tell, lots of hotels now line the shoreline. And it is very, very busy, especially in the summer. Shoreline on our left, your port side. This is going to be an old gravel receiving dock that was built back in 1915 by a man named Harvey Whitney. And he owned a construction company up here in Duluth. And he wanted to build this receiving dock to provide less congestion throughout the harbor. Because back then, 35 to 40 ships passed through the canal that we just came out of every single day. And so there were docks that stretched here all the way down the shoreline. And what he did not take into the heavy waves that crash against our shoreline, especially in fall, which is our stormiest season. And so after 3 years of being in business, he had to close down. But this structure does still get put to good use in the summer months when it's warm enough to go swimming. People use that as a dining platform, because there's lots of deep water that's around it. And actually, just this winter, there was a piece of the receiving dock that broke off. And because of the deep water and strong current that was below the ice, it got swept into deeper waters, and we were never able to trace where it went. Continuing looking at our shoreline, we're coming up on this mural here, this blue, gray, and white mural. That's actually a mosaic mural made over 1 million pieces. Seeing the history of the Twin Ports. On the left, it's going to be the earliest history of the Twin Ports, and all the way to the right, it's going to be the most current. And actually, behind that mural is going to be our highway. You can't tell because it is a tunnel system here in town. Originally, when they wanted to expand Highway 61 through Duluth up the North Shore, they were going to make a four-story tall freeway system. And Duluth citizens begged them not to, because it was going to take away this absolutely gorgeous lake view that we love so much. And so, luckily for us, they did listen. And they vetoed that project and instead thought of this tunnel system. So everything we're about to see, all these buildings on the shoreline there above, are Highway 61. You'll see people in front of that mural walking, running, biking. They're using our lake walk. The lake walk's pretty cool. It starts at the Duluth Ship Canal and stretches for about 3 miles down our shoreline, and it connects to other hiking trails throughout Duluth. We see this white structure against the shoreline. This is the Vietnam Memorial. It was dedicated back in 1992 on Memorial Day. It holds the five emblems of our armed forces, and it's dedicated for the 136 men and women that did not return home from war. Those 136 names are engraved in a stone behind that white structure. And what's really cool about the memorial is that it was completely funded by private donations. We see this building here with the smokestack and the red water tower. This is going to be Vickers Complex. Vickers Brewing has been around for a very long time. They were both before the Prohibition. And during the Prohibition, they sold candy and soda. At least that's what they told the government they did. And when they were going to make the four-story tall freeway system, they shut down Vickers because it was not going to be kept up. But the tunnel system allowed it to stay up. So they actually renovated that building, and now it's home to Vickers Brewery, Vickers Hotel, and about five or six other restaurants, and tons of shops in there. That blue staircase you see next to it, that leads you up to that smaller building that used to be a gas station. Now it's going to be the Portland Malt Shop, when the best ice cream stops in town. And all of this is conveniently located on our lake walk. coming up on this tree here on the shoreline. This is going to mark Lake Erickson Park. Lake Erickson was a Viking that settled here in the 1800s. And lots of cool stuff happens at Lake Erickson. Actually, starting tonight, there's going to be a Movies in the Park night every Friday night. They put out a huge projection screen up there. It's free to the public. And about a couple hundred people every single Friday night turn out at Lake Erickson Park. This year, the Movies in the Park theme is going to be All-Star. So they're playing, I think, a league of their own tonight. Below the castle structure, you'll see the rock beaches there. They are just as popular as the sandy beach over at Park Point because they are so conveniently located on the lake walk. You see this retaining wall here just past Lake Erickson that is continuing on our highway. And actually above the highway is going to be this rose garden up here, which is pretty cool. Hundreds and hundreds of roses bloom every springtime for us. You'll see that white gazebo. That is a very popular wedding photo and engagement photo spot. And to the right of the retaining wall, you'll see cars on the road. That's where the tunnel system ends. And if you keep going, that's where it's going to lead you over to the North Shore. Some people may be visiting Glensheen Mansion while you're here. And that's going to be a good mile and a half, 2 miles down the shoreline. It's going to be a very gorgeous day here in Duluth, quite warm. So you may want to go swimming later, advise if you're the shoreline, but it will be very chilly. I have a free beverage, it's so warm up here on Third Jack. I have a free beverage for anyone that can tell me the average temperature of Lake Superior. Time is incorrect.
43.
Lower. So close.
36.
You're not as close.
38.
You're so close. 39. What's your name, sir?
Mike.
Mike, congratulations. You can go to either first deck or second deck to claim your free beverage.
All right.
Of any kind. You need alcohol on this Friday. You know you're one of those. Congratulations, Mike. 39 degrees is the average temperature on Lake Superior. Quite chilly. Press on our shoreline. But typically, about now is when people will start going swimming, mid-July, early August. Depending on how rough the has been, we had a very warm winter this year. But 2014 was one of the worst winters we've had on record. Some people might remember the polar vortex. It is pretty hard up here. There was still ice on the water on my birthday, June 1st. So that was a brutal one. We did not go swimming that year. It was quite too cold. And despite being so cold, the Lakeland rarely freezes over completely. There's only 6 times on record that the lake has frozen over completely, and that's because it is the largest freshwater lake by surface area in the world. It's about the same surface area as the state of South Carolina. And so the last time it froze over was in 2014, but it hadn't frozen over in quite a number of years. So 6 times on record there has been a piece of ice the size of South Carolina just off to the shores. The depth changes very sporadically in Lake Superior. The average depth is going to be about 498 feet. The deepest point is 1,332 feet deep, which means that you can take the Empire State Building in New York City and put it at that deepest point, and on the top floor of the Empire State Building, you're going to be 8 stories underwater.
Where's Fitzgerald at?
One more time?
Down by
Canadian.
Yeah.
Maritime. I thought that was
Lake Superior is so large that on a clear day like today, you could stand on the top of this hill and look out Lake Superior. You'd see 35 miles out, and you'd only be looking at 1.5% of its surface area. There's so much water here in the lake that each of us in the world could have half of an Olympic swimming pool to ourselves. Alrighty, we are making our way back to the Duluth Canal. You'll see the bridges in front of us there. This is actually not the natural entrance into our harbor. If you look down this sandy beach here on our left side, this is Park Point over here, and this sandy beach stretches about 7 miles down. It's completely open to the public, which is really cool. Just a short walk over the aerial lift bridge to this beach. But all the way down, it's a very clear day, so you're gonna see some land over there, and kind of you'll maybe be able to make out a structure that's out in the water there. That is the Superior
Harbor, your lighthouse, that's the natural entrance into this harbor. When Duluth was founded in 1854, they quickly realized that they wanted their own entrance because they wanted to start their own port, their own business on the water. And so they started digging where you see the aerial lift bridge today. And when Superior got wind that they wanted their own, they were not too happy about that at all. And so they got an army officer in Kansas to write an injunction to stop the digging. And the key to this is that the army officer's train was delayed 24 hours when he was trying to come up here. And in that 24 hours, Duluth heard that this was going to happen. And thousands of citizens from Duluth came to where you see the bridge today, and they started digging. They started digging their own canal. And they dug so fast, and there were so many of them that were digging at the same time, that in a 24-hour period, they were able to get a tugboat to go through. And by getting the tugboat to go through, it meant that the digging was done, that they could stop. And when the army officer got up here, he no longer could serve that injunction because they officially had their own canal. So he told Superior, he said, "You're going to have to keep fighting this and go higher up. There's nothing I can do for you." And Superior did just that. They went all the way up to the U.S. Supreme Court to try and stop Duluth from having their own entrance into this harbor. And luckily for us, the Supreme Court said that we could have our own entrance. And actually, Superior's fear that Duluth was going to steal business from them, the opposite ended up happening. Superior's business was never better, and Duluth's business boomed. And then decades later, the government decided to make us one official port. So that is what we refer to as the twin ports. That's Duluth's business and Superior's business combined. And we've always been a very busy port, and right now we are the 15th busiest in the United States, despite only being open 10 months out of the year.
You'll see some lighthouses ahead of us here. The one on our left with the red roof, steady green light. The one closer to the bridge on the left side, that's going to have a revolving white light. It also has the harbor's foghorn. We don't necessarily need the foghorn anymore. Lots of boats have the technology that they have their own radar equipment that can guide them into the canal on foggier days. But we do still use the foghorn. I like to keep it classic here in Duluth. And on the right, you're going to see a solo lighthouse. That's the first lighthouse that was ever built in 1909 on our harbor. And that has a flashing red light that comes on at night. The U.S. Coast Guard maintains and operates all three of these lighthouses. It may seem like a tough job, but they say it's just a bit of lighthouse keeping. What? A lighthouse joke? I do want to talk about a really cool museum that we have here in town. Just to the right of the aerial lift bridge in Canal Park is going to be our maritime museum. Lots of cool shipping news in that museum. All the vessels that are coming into port, what they're carrying, where they're going while they're here, and then where they're going after they're here. I do want to warn you guys that are outside when we do go underneath this bridge. Captain Tim and the bridge operator are going to do a little hello, hello, very loud horn. So that'll be a great time to plug those ears when you go underneath there. I'll give you another warning when we do so.
Minnesota Ballet and Minnesota Opera performs here. barges go out and they dredge the harbor to make sure that it maintains the same depth of 28 feet throughout. But it looks like the barge is also helping us dredge out that slip there, that body of water next to the silos you see with the banner on there. This construction over here is the expansion project of Canal Park. We're really excited about this here in Duluth. They're going to be building up more hotels and restaurants over here. That banner is on the old barge cement terminal, those silos you see there. And they're actually going to keep up those silos and build the hotel around it. So if you guys are visiting, maybe next summer you'll be back up and you'll be staying at the old barge cement terminal. Really cool about this is that you'll be able to get there on car on land and also be able to pull up your boat. We'll see another barge that's out here just past the terminal. They are definitely dredging the water for that 28 feet depth that needs to be maintained throughout our harbor. This is the job of the U.S. Coast Guard.
These next yellow structures, these silos we see here, this is one integrated terminal. This is Riverland Agriculture Corporation. It was previously owned by Cargill. Riverland owns it now, and there's a 5-mile long conveyor belt that is connecting to the two terminals. Bushels an hour, but that was actually too fast and that was damaging the holds of the ships, and so they brought it down to 35,000 bushels of grain an hour. This next building here, this is going to be owned by Ceres Agricultural Group. You see the red gantry spout on the side there. Ceres is really cool. They have a state-of-the-art cleaning system, so before they load up the grain, they clean out dunnage and other waste from it, which saves a lot of money and time. They can hold about 14.2 million bushels of grain in there. And they load up with that red gantry spout. The spout itself cannot move, and so when a boat loads up at Ceres, it has to move up and down the slip of water by itself to fully load up. The past Ceres is going to be Ascon Scrap Dock, clearly one of the most gorgeous sites in the harbor. They are one of the coolest. They recycle pretty much anything steel-related they can get their hands on, which is why we drive quickly past it. They're going to take old railroad cars and old parts from boats. They dismantle them, break them down, and then they reuse all of that steel to make new boat parts and new railroad parts. This gray building coming up here at the Green Garage doors, this is going to mark the beginning of Port Terminal. All the land we're about to see here coming up is a huge middle ground for cargo called Port Terminal. Lots of cargo get brought here by international boats, and then they will go in the United States, or they will be loaded back onto boats going to different countries. But starting off Port Terminal is going to be the Calumet Fuel Station here on the corner. Calumet is our gas station for boats. They can load about 50,000 to 80,000 gallons of fuel into a vessel at about 9 gallons a second. It seems like horrible fuel efficiency, but when you take into account how much cargo these boats can carry, it's 6 times more fuel efficient than carrying cargo by railroad car, and about 60 times more fuel efficient than carrying cargo by semi-truck. Harbor, whether or not they are on schedule, they will stop here before they go to the terminal that they are designated to go to. Or if they are behind schedule, they'll go to that terminal and then they will absolutely fuel up before they leave.
So they fuel up right here?
Yeah, they
just pull up right here on the side, and then those
doesn't look like they've got enough bulk fuel on hand to fill them much of anything.
You'd be surprised.
Yeah.
Yeah, a lot of them underground as well.
Right, yep.
Coming up on these wind turbine parks here in Middle Spot, these wind turbine parks come from all over the world, places like the Bahamas, and places like, there was just a boat from Liberia that brought these wind turbine parks. It's also a plant in Grand Forks, made in the U.S. as well. You'll see one now being loaded onto this semi-truck bed. They are over 150 feet long, and this is actually only one of three parts that make a windmill blade. And then they're going to go inland in the United States, and they'll get put up as windmills that we see when we're driving in farm country USA. But as you can see, they are so massive that each semi-truck that carries these needs two escorts on the highway to get where they're going. Here. These came from a boat in Hong Kong, China. The Eider unloaded about 3,000 steel pipes when it was all said and done. This is for a pipeline project. We just found this out. That is going to connect Canada all the way down to Texas. But the catch is that they haven't even signed the bill for that pipeline.
Is that Sandpiper? Enberg? Sandpiper pipeline?
I have no idea.
Oh. It's a Trans-Canadian pipeline.
We're coming up on these really cool boats here. These are our tugboats in our harbor. These are the Duluth tugboats. There's going to be four of them. One of them is out helping a barge today. We have the Minnesota, the Indiana, and the Arkansas right here. The North Carolina is the one that is out. And the North Carolina is the same length and width of the boat that we are on right now, the Vista Star. As you can see, they look a lot smaller. But there's a lot of boat underwater that we can't see. They're kind of like icebergs. And so the front, there's going to be about 6 feet, and then in the stern section, there's about 14 feet of boat that we can't see underneath the water. And that makes them excellent icebreakers for us here in the colder months when we have some ice build up on the lake. They're also really good at navigating through tough weather, so if it's really stormy on the lake, they'll go out and help the boats get through our harbor without crashing into things. And most boats have the technology now that are called bow thrusters, and they can navigate themselves throughout the harbor on their own. But if they don't have the bow thruster, that's when the tugboats will go out. And even on a clear day like today, they will help them navigate into the terminal they need to be at. This silo here with that L shape on top, this is one of the coolest terminals in the harbor. It's the tallest building in Duluth. And this is the Wholesome Terminal. It's a powdered cement spot here. And what's really cool is when a boat will come here at to Wholesome, on their long journey on the water, that powdered cement becomes really compacted. And so in order to break it up, you'll see that auger or the arm that's near the waterline. That goes into the hold of the ship and it starts drilling. And all the while it's drilling, there's a vacuum that's taking out the newly powdered cement. And because of this process, they can't stop after, you know, an 8-hour shift and go home for the night, because that would mean a lot of costly delays, and it would take a lot longer because the powdered cement would become compacted. connected again. So they work about 50 to 60 hours straight when a boat pulls up to Holson without stopping to get all of that powdered cement off of there. And this brown bridge that's right next to Holson here that we're about to pass by, this is the old interstate bridge. There are about 7 or 8 of these throughout the harbor back in the day. This is the only one that's still standing. And it did stand in this spot a little farther out in the water. And when a boat would want to pass by, it was a swivel bridge. It would just pivot out of the way for these boats to go through. It was the only point connecting Duluth, Minnesota to Superior, Wisconsin. And so there was a toll to cross this bridge. It was 10 cents per car and 5 cents per person in the car. So our captain, Tim, remembers being put in the trunk of the car, so his parents did not have to pay that nickel for the cross. And this high bridge that we're going under, we do call it the High Bridge, or also the John A. Blotnick Bridge. John A. Blotnick is the Minnesota congressman that got the funding for this bridge to be built. When they wanted to build another bridge here, they were actually going to build a lift bridge, a second lift bridge over here. And Duluth citizens and Superior citizens said that that was not a smart idea. That would cause a lot of traffic, boat traffic and on the road for the cars. And so John A. Blotnick came through with this idea to just make a bridge that was tall enough for any vessel to go underneath uninterrupted and any car to be able to go over uninterrupted as well. And that's exactly what they did. So this has a clearance of 200 feet. So any vessel, the largest vessels in our port can travel under here without interruption. You'll see these cylinders that are by the water. Are in the water by the bridge here. We call these dolphins, so we like to say we do have dolphins in Lake Superior, but they're also called fenders. They're in place in case a boat on a very foggy, stormy day, if they were ever to bump in and get too close to the bridge, they will bump into those fenders and the bridge will be spared, which is a very good feeling for those people driving. This land was built to connect a railroad bridge that was going from these terminals on our plane all the way over to Duluth. And that was built back in 1885. And then just about 1985, the bridge itself was taken down. But as you can see, the island is still very popular to a number of birds.
be the Mississauga Docks, owned by the Canadian National Railroad. This terminal handles cargo going in two different directions. So there's taconite pellets, which is a processed form of iron ore, and those are brought here on railroad from Minnesota's Iron Range and loaded onto ships for steel mills on the Lower Lakes. And then limestone comes from Michigan by boat and taken by railroad to the Iron Range, where it's used in the process of making taconite pellets. These docks originally handled iron ore in its raw form, which contained about 60% iron, but the mining efforts of World War II and the Korean War used up all of that high-quality ore. There's still plenty of iron in the ground, but it was trapped in a rock called taconite, which has only about 30% iron. So to ship that in its natural form would have been really expensive and wasteful. So steel companies worked with the University of Minnesota to come up with a way to refine the taconite ore. How it works is at the Iron Range taconite plant, the rock is crushed into a fine powder, and magnetic separators draw out as much iron as possible, yielding a black dust called concentrate. The concentrate is almost pure iron, but it would be too difficult to transport to steel mills. So to ease that concentrate's journey, it's combined with clay, rolled into marble-sized, marble-shaped pellets, and baked at 2400 degrees Fahrenheit. Some plants also add limestone to their pellets, which is a key ingredient in steel mill blast furnaces. So these structures we see here are a unique type of structure that can only be found around Lake Superior. These are the largest of the docks that were ever built. Dock 6 is going to be on our right, Dock 5 on our left. Dock 6 is the only one that's open. Dock 5 no longer handles cargo over there. But Dock 6 still does. If you look at the cross section at the end of Dock 6, you can kind of see how they work. There are four sets of train tracks atop the dock, which lead down into the triangular storage pockets. The tops of the pockets are open, so trains overhead can open their hopper bottoms and dump directly into them. Each car carries 75 tons of ore, and each pocket holds about four carloads. So these chutes that are at the chutes that are on the ore docks, they can lower down right into the hold of a ship, and then they open up those pockets, and all of the ore just slides down into the hold of the ship. And a full pocket can send about 300 tons of ore into a ship in 40 seconds. You'll see farther down on Dock 6, these chutes kind of end, and then you see these conveyor belts that are down there. Those were built back in the 70s because the Great Lakes started having 1,000-footers built. And these boats were too large to pull up right next to these chutes. And so instead, those conveyor belts go down until they are horizontal with the hold of the boat, and then the conveyor belt starts moving and bringing on the iron ore. So that's how they get, that's how those 1,000-footers will get loaded up. Dock 6 does stay very busy still, but these docks saw the peak of their activity during World War II, when Lake Superior mines provided the mass majority of the iron behind the U.S. steel production. And the busiest day that these docks ever saw was June 7th, 1994. That was the day after the Normandy invasion. And in that 24-hour period, Docks 5 and 6 loaded 35 ships with 406,000 tons of iron ore. We'll see another barge here on coming up on our right. And this is actually digging up old taconite that has fallen into the water. So they are digging up all this taconite, and they are going to be able to reuse it. Here, if you look to our right, this is Dock 5. At the end of Dock 5, you're going to see some mangled steel that's kind of hanging in the middle there. That mangled steel is there because there was a train conductor a number of years ago that was pushing what he thought was a string of 96 ore cars out onto the dock. It turned out that he had 98 ore cars. And so two of those landed right in old Lady Superior here in our harbor. Some people who witnessed the accident of those train cars said it looked like he just lost his train of thought.
Others say he was just in dire need of a little R&R. Either way, he probably went through a lot of retraining in order to get his career back on track. Don't blame me, folks. I don't write the jokes. I just get railroaded into telling them. We'll go back to the drawing board, and we'll try and re-engineer them. Okay, that's the last one. That's the last railroad joke.
Ahead of us here is the Superior Midwest Energy Terminal. This is not only the busiest dock in our harbor, it's the busiest shipping terminal of any kind on the entire Great Lakes and St. Lawrence Seaway. If Midwest Energy were considered to be its own port, it would rank as the 40th busiest in the U.S. This is also the largest single-point coal terminal in North America, single-point meaning that it loads one ship at a time. 4 to 5 trains here arrive daily, each carrying about 14,000 tons of coal and 123 cars. They come mostly from Wyoming's Powder River and Hanna basins, but also from Montana, Colorado, Utah, and British Columbia. The coal then travels by conveyor to the overhead stacker, and the crew of this dock spreads the stockpile out from the stacker using giant 935 horsepower bulldozers with pusher blades that are 15 feet tall and 30 feet wide. The stockpile you can see there, that holds up to about 5 million tons of coal, and it measures up to 4 blocks wide, 6 blocks long, and 12 stories tall. To keep the dust down from the coal, the pile is hosed down by high-powered water canyons that are located throughout the terminal. You'll see a large gray structure on the face of the dock. That's going to be the fastest ship loader for coal in the United States. It can load 11,500 tons per hour, or 3 tons per second. So Midwest Energy, they were completed in 1976 at a cost of $43 million, but this 200-acre facility went from blueprints to an operational terminal in just 14 months, and that excellent design and quick construction won it the Civil Engineering Award for 1976. That's the year's greatest civil engineering achievement, and a couple of cool things have won that award as well, the Golden Gate Bridge and the Hoover Dam, and now a good old Midwest Energy. Next to Midwest Energy is General Mills Superior Terminal, which General Mills leases from the Burlington Northern Santa Fe Railroad. The oldest elevator is going to be farther down on the shoreline here. That was built in 1900, and it was the world's largest grain elevator. And even after over a century of being in use, it does still load 15 to 25 ships every year. The main cargo includes wheat, headed for East Coast markets via flour mills in Buffalo, New York. On the other side of General Mills, you can see that there are going to be three gray boxy structures. These are the old remains of the Globe Elevator, the last wooden grain elevator in our harbor. And there used to be a number of these throughout the harbor, but the combination of wood and grain dust is extremely flammable. And all these others either burned safer concrete structures. These were built back in 1887 and used until 1998. And a local company owns them now. And they are slowly dismantling these guys because of all of the great architectural value that the wood inside holds.
This is Minnesota-based CHS Incorporated, the largest ship-loading grain terminal in North America. It has a storage capacity of 18.5 million bushels of grain.
That's enough to give every person in Africa a loaf of bread. They are the only terminal in our harbor that will load two boats at once. Underneath the bridge, I want you guys to look way down on our right or starboard side. You're going to see this tan boat in the distance here, kind of blending in with the terminal. That is the JB4. That's the oldest boat in our terminal. That boat has been on the water 8 years before the Titanic sank. She's seen lots and lots of water, well over 100 years old. And that's a testament to just how long lake water boats can last. They last about four times as long as boats that see salt water. And the JB Ford was going to go to Ascon, but they found a case of asbestos on there, so they are trying asbestos they can. What? An asbestos joke? Come on. They're trying as best as they can to get rid of that so that they can bring her to Ascon and take all of that great steel that is on the boat and reuse it. But for now, she is permanently there where you see her, and is one of my favorite parts of the harbor. Now is going to be the beautiful shoreline of Duluth, Minnesota. Duluth was founded back in 1854, and it's always been very popular with trading. People were moving out west, people were bringing goods back east. And this was sort of a sweet middle spot right here. And we continue to be that sweet middle spot. Every January, we shut down business, and we don't reopen until mid-March. And so that's the only time that we're not doing trading here in our harbor. Like I said before, earlier, we are a 10-month port. And we do have vessels that stay here in those winter months. And each vessel that stays here during the wintertime adds about $800,000 to our economy. Duluth is very interesting in its shape itself. It's going to be about 26 or 27 miles long from east to west, but going inland, up the hill, it's only going to be about a mile and a half to 2 miles inland. And because it's on the hill, it adds very interesting weather patterns here. In the winter time, I'll be walking to work. It'll be a cold day, but I live by the lake, and so it'll be the sun will be shining. It'll be a gorgeous winter day here in Duluth. And I'll have a coworker call me and say, I'm snowed in, this crazy blizzard, there's no way I can get to work today. And I'll look up at the sun and I'll be like, you're a liar, get to work, no excuse. And in fact, she is snowed in, she just lives 2 miles inland, and it's much colder inland in the wintertime than it is by the lake. And in the summer, it's the opposite effect. I have friends that live up on the hill, and they'll be like, it's 90 degrees, absolutely gorgeous day, come over, we're making burgers. And I'm by the lake with four sweatshirts on, absolutely freezing, because it is much colder by the lake in the summertime than it is up on the hill. So there's a cool kind of breeze today up on the hill. I guarantee you it's a good 5-6 degrees warmer up that hill there. I do want to point out a really cool sightseeing spot. If you look to your left and on top of that hill there, above Riverland Aquarium, you'll see a tower-like structure. That is going to be Enger Tower, built by a man named B.J. Enger. He owned the land up there. When he passed away, he gave it to the city of Duluth. And so the city of Duluth took it over and built there's a golf course up there, really cool gardens up there, and the tower itself holds one of the best views of the harbor, the lake, and the city of Duluth all at once. It's very gorgeous. You can get there taking Skyline Drive. So as I mentioned before, the U.S. Coast Guard is going to be in charge of the dredging, making sure that the harbor maintains that 28-foot depth. Their boat right now is coming up on the right. This is the Alder. The Alder is a very cool boat. Lots of cool equipment on the Alder. They have oil spill cleanup equipment. They have great navigational skills. They can break through 3 feet of ice, no problem. And she has seen lots and lots of water. She's responsible for all of the water on the U.S. side of Lake Superior. And she's actually seen much colder water than 39 degrees Fahrenheit. She made her way up to high Arctic waters in 2010 with Danish and Canadian boats. And they were running drills for if there would ever be some kind of terrorist attack on the waters. And although it is a smaller boat, there's going to be a crew of 50 people aboard the Eider. Or the Alder, excuse me. People often refer to boats in the feminine pronoun with she or her, and it's because back in the day when it was primarily males that were working aboard boats, male captains especially, they were very superstitious, and so it was said that women could calm the seas, and the women that they were traveling away from or trying to get home to, they could think of them and they could refer to their boat in the feminine pronoun that would calm the seas and they could have a safe journey. I also like to say it's because women can do everything. Write that down, guys. Write it down. Guys, ahead of us now is our Duluth dock, which means that our tour is slowly but surely coming to a close. I do have a couple safety things as we get you back on land. We're going to be doing lines on the back of the boat, on the stern, so I need you to stay off the stern, the back of the boat, and off the staircases for me. And then once we do have those lines on, we do need Captain Tim's all ashore to get you guys on land. So just sit tight. You're more than welcome to stay on the bows and on third deck. And on second deck, I need you off the staircases and off of the back of the boat on first deck here. Thank you guys so much for joining us. What a gorgeous day in Duluth. Morning. If you have any last minute questions before you head off, feel free to ask me those. I'm going to be at the end of the ramp when you guys get off the boat if you need any tips on what to see, what to do the rest of your time here in Duluth. Great at giving you guys tips. Pretty darn good at receiving them too, ladies and gentlemen. But what? The jokes keep coming, right? If you enjoyed your tour, my name is Mackenzie. If you did not, my name is Mon. Feel free to give us a like on Facebook, leave us a review. We are always trying to change these tours to better fit what the public want to see, what the public want to hear. Thank you guys again so much. Enjoy the rest of your day here in beautiful Duluth, Minnesota. Take care.
Be careful out there.